When you leave the international airport of Rio de Janeiro and head towards the south of the city, which is where all the beaches are, you pass a sprawling informal settlement called Mare. It's one of hundreds of neglected shanty towns like this in Rio. It goes on for miles. But when you pass by there today, all you see is this wall. Look at this map of Rio. Here's the part that you probably know. It's the south zone. It's where all the iconic beaches are. Mare is in Rio's north zone, which is where most of the city's poor live.
This acoustic barrier, according to them, was to block sound, but it's very clear that the only purpose for this wall is so that people who leave the airport to the south zone don't catch a glimpse of the reality of this city.
They don't have sewage systems, they don't have housing rights, they don't have anything. But, you know, the city is really concerned about how loud the cars are because they're worried about, you know, the ears of the poor people that don't have food in their stomach.
The city just installed a big new school in this community a few months ago. You'll note that when we get to this part of the highway, the wall becomes totally transparent, giving us a perfect view of the shiny school.
Every time international attention comes to Rio, the city scrambles to build up infrastructure around tourism for visitors to see that it's this amazing city. The problem is the visitors will come and they go, but the people of Rio are here to stay. And they're frustrated. They're frustrated that their government will spend so much money to build up certain parts of the city and completely neglect others. The Olympics is no different in this case. In fact, it's probably the biggest excuse Rio has to pour tons of money into making the city look good.
This is Patricia. She rides the buses here in Rio and has noticed a major change in the bus routes recently.
It used to be a line who left Ramos, which is in the north zone, to Cosme Velho, where we have the Christ. And this line was extinguished.
Patricia is showing me a few examples of the 11 bus lines that were cut between the poor north zone and the touristy rich south zone, all in preparation for the Olympics. It's now much harder for a resident of the north zone to get down to the beaches of Ipanema or Copacabana. So why cut the bus line?
If all of these black people, poor people, barefoot people are there, it's like, no, we have to clean this. And they always wanted to clean, but now they have a purpose, they have a deadline to do this.
If discriminatory bus lines are bad, here's where it gets worse. So back to this map. Out here in the west is a place called Baja. R's are pronounced like H in Portuguese. This is a new part of the city where a lot of the Olympics action is happening. It's where the Olympics Park is going to be built. And because of this, it's home to what one real estate publication is calling a cosmopolitan awakening. Tons of real estate investment. And of course, a bunch of dramatic promotional videos to go with it. There's this one guy named Carlos Carvalho. He's a real estate developer, and he owns 64 million square feet in Baja. Last year, in a series of interviews with big publications, Carvalho sketched out his dream for Baja. His goal is to turn this place into a new Rio, a city for the elite, of good taste, noble housing, not housing for the poor. This guy's the 12th richest person in Brazil, and he's got a ton of political influence to make his dream happen. Here he is with Rio's mayor, whose re-election campaign he generously donated to. They're just, you know, looking over plans for how they're going to reshape Baja. But there's one big problem for people like Carlos Carvalho and his dream to make Baja a haven for the rich.
If your interest is in land value, the less poor people you have in your land, the greater value you can give it to it. They think of the city as a place for you to invest in, not a place for you to live in.
Over the years, little settlements of a few hundred families have popped up in Baja. It's usually workers unable to find affordable housing and creating communities of their own. These places have been around for decades, and many of them have gained legal status for their property. But to the luxury-minded developers of this new part of town, these informal settlements represent a barrier to their plan. So when the Olympic Park was planned for this area of Rio, it wasn't much of a surprise when the city came in with eminent domain eviction orders, telling these communities that they would be moved to public housing complexes, usually far out of sight of any international visitors. Most communities left, some happily taking the money that the city gave them. Some mounted intense but failed resistance. But I visited one community that didn't give up on the fight to keep their homes.
When they announced that the Olympics would be here in Rio de Janeiro, we knew our problems were going to get worse.
Vila Autódromo was a community of around 600 families near where the Olympic Park is being built. It's not on the actual park property, but it's in the site of the park. This is what it looks like today.
People chose to go there because there was no drug trafficking or militia. It was very safe, very good sense of community, near jobs, near schools. It's hard to know that when you just visit the community. But you kind of get a sense of that by seeing the people who are still resisting, you know, because they're holding on to that memory and they want to keep some of that alive.
After years of fighting with the city hall, only 20 families of the original 600 remain in this community. Fierce protesting and a flurry of international press got the mayor to finally concede, saying that the 20 families could stay on condition that the city would build them nicer-looking homes, lest, heaven forbid, the international community catch a glimpse of the real Rio.
We had fruit trees that fed us, that we planted ourselves, and now we will have to plant them all over again. Every corner of every house was constructed with care. The trees, the plants. Why couldn't Vila Autódromo remain adjacent to the park? It is some urban planning reason? No, there's none. It's because of economic interests, which are tied to real estate valuation. There's no other reason. Even though I'm mentally prepared and I knew that my house would be demolished soon, for me, that was the worst part of this whole process.
Through the long fight, some of Vila Autódromo was able to stay. But this is rare. Most communities that receive eviction orders no longer exist. At least 77,200 people have been removed from their homes in Rio de Janeiro since 2009. That's according to government data. And much of this is to make way for infrastructure and real estate projects associated with the World Cup and the Olympic Games.
So it's kind of a shame because the Olympics ends up coming in and kind of whitewashing the areas and creating and reframing them. And, you know, you lose a lot of the personality of the city.
Of course, there have been numerous benefits to the people of Rio thanks to the Olympics investments. New bus lines, revitalizations of old parts of the city, museums, parks. This stuff will make life better in the city for sure. But in the end, billions of public dollars that were supposed to benefit the people ended up bowing to the interests of a few people with a lot of money. And instead of investing in the underserved, Rio will once again hide them from view.
You wouldn't think that it's, you know, it was just, you would think that there was just a smattering of black people in Brazil. I mean, when I say black people that look like black people in Central Africa. Mm-hmm. But the numbers are huge. But they all push back up in those hills. But when it comes to classification, from what I understand, Brazilians will tell you, we don't have any discrimination here. You know, everybody's the same. Color don't make no difference here. This is Brazil.
The Katherine Massey Book Club, live in Buffalo, New York, the context of white supremacy. Gus T. Renegade, in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Thursday, February 16, 2023, so I have been told. This is our sixth installment on Mário Filho's The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. We're picking up on section 2.5, moving right along through the text. The segment that we heard at the beginning, that was from Vox, V-O-X, their 2016 report when the Olympics were in Rio de Janeiro, and they talked about how they moved all of the black people out of the poor areas, and they put up the wall so when people were traveling to the different stadiums and venues, they wouldn't have to see where the poor dark people in Brazil live, and then tearing down the houses and moving them further back up into the Amazon. And they actually show that on the map where they moved them back to, which we actually heard in the text. That was why some of the black soccer players, they had to go travel very, very far from where they lived and where their family lived at. And so that's why they would stay in the dormitories and what have you for the soccer teams. But we heard that directly in the book. They also, in that Vox report, they talked about how they eliminated some of the bus lines because they didn't want unsightly dark people down messing things up on the beach. And they talked about the eminent domain, which gives them the right, haven't we heard that before, to tear down all of the housing for white ball games. We had Chinwizu as a guest on our program way back in 2011. He's an African scholar. He was on from the continent, and he has a report talking about racism and the Olympics, and it starts with that sentence, why are we, non-white people, black people, why are we so consumed with the white man's ball games, with white people's amusements? Certainly this here book, soccer, and why you have all of the street urchins starting the food that came up again, not even having food. In fact, fruit trees. I was instantly Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, starving black people, North America or South America. Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, his documentary just came out right behind the book that we read. In his book, he talked about they didn't have food. They would go out, pecan trees and all the rest of it. Thank goodness that they had all these fruit trees down in the Delta of Mississippi where he grew up. You heard the very same thing. Dark people down in Brazil, we had our fruit trees. That's how we could eat. They came and ripped all of that down with our dilapidated housing and booted us further into the Amazon. What does it mean to be black anywhere in the known universe? Black, get back. We will proceed. Audio segment number one of the black man in Brazilian soccer, the Katherine Massey Book Club. Audio segment one.
Chapter 2, Part 5. And Montega never again made an appearance for America. The Borgeses and the Curtis had won. They could return to Campos Sales. The president of America was no longer Joao Santos. It was Raul Reis. Montega wanted to stay in Bahia. Well, America would not send anyone to look for him. Raul Reis was even liking that things had turned out like this. Not that he had anything against mulattoes and blacks. Montego had gone, but Miranda had stayed, more alone now without Montega. And there were certain days when he could not flee, having to sleep at the club. America had placed 20 beds in the hallway, transforming it into a dormitory. America was considering the advantages that Fluminense had in 1917, 1918, and 1919. And Flamengo in 1920 and 1921. The players sleeping at the club, waking up for individual training, eating breakfast before going to the field, eating a good steak and two fried eggs after the training session, Mr. Taylor at Fluminense and Platero at Flamengo. Although America had no Mr. Taylor or Platero, it did have Jaime Barcelos, Henrique Chuckle Santos, and Dr. Mota Resende, the little bat, each contributing his ideas. Jaime Barcelo suggested using the chairs for training. About 10 of the chairs from America's hall were put out in the field, and the players had to pass through them with the ball at their feet. If the ball hit a chair, the player lost. The whole training session would be a competition. Almost always the one who won was Osvaldinho. He only liked to train with the ball. It was tough to get him to do the gymnastics class with Dr. Pimenta de Mello, opening and closing his arms, twisting his torso with his legs apart, squatting, then rising. The players would not take their eyes off him. What he did, everyone had to copy. Osvaldinho would repeat Dr. Pimento de Melo's gestures one or two times and then stop, bored. Who had ever seen something like that? Soccer was played with the ball at one's feet, and games with the ball were Osvaldinho's thing. He could stay all day on the field, even without anyone else there, kicking corners, calculating his kicks. He could shoot the ball wherever he wished. The poor boys with their mouths agape. Someone could say, "Hit the bar," and he would hit it. "Make it go in the corner," and he would go there. For Osvaldinho, individual training had only one good thing besides the chair competition, leapfrog. The players would play leapfrog like high school kids. Whoever had just leapfrogged would bend down right away so the next person could leap over him. A good frog to leap over was Chiquinho, who was a tiny little guy. Chiquinho barely bent over at all, just lowering his head. At the last moment, he would leave his place, and the player who was preparing to leap, who had already calculated where he would place his hands, would fall over. Everyone laughed at Chiquinho's antics, and the time would pass more quickly. Individual training always ended at 9 o'clock. After that, it was time for brunch. The players could choose on the previous day the brunch menu, varying the food, preferring at times a hot chocolate with toast. There was always a club member who would provide the food. Raul Reis, Joao Santos, Lafayette Gomez Ribeiro, Artur Lietau. There was no lack of wealthy members with the will to feed the America team well. Even Florentino, owner of the Alfonso Pena Cafe. Often the players would be eating a brunch like Raul Reis or Joao Santos when a waiter would arrive from Alfonso Pena Cafe, whom Florentino had sent. Florentino's specialties were horse steaks and scrambled eggs with ham. The players would eat everything. After an intense training session, there was no lack of appetite. It was these mornings when Miranda managed to forget that he was a mulatto. He would laugh with the others at Chinquino's antics and enjoy his food as much as the others. But that forgetfulness was short-lived, as he would remember when he left for work and passed by America's hall. He continued not showing up there, even on the days when he had to sleep at the club. The others went to the hall and stayed there chatting until bedtime, but not Miranda. Bedtime was at 10. Before 10, no one saw him. At 10, however, he was already in the dormitory, changing his clothes. He would put on his pajamas, lie down, and try to close his eyes right away. He remained Miranda, even more Miranda than before, because he saw himself alone with Manteiga in Bahia. When Manteiga played for America, Miranda did not wear a cap. Now he started to wear a cap to hide his bad hair. Not because of him, but because of America. With a cap, he could pass as a bit browner than the others, showing his little bit of race, but without drawing much attention. He did not want to draw attention, which is why he put the cap on his head. Soccer had reverted to being as white as it had been in 1919. The best whites had returned, so that what had happened in 1921 would not happen again, that is, allowing mulattoes and blacks to take their places. When one looked at the Fluminense team, it was almost that of 1919. Marcos Vidal and Mota Maia, Laís, Bordalho, Fortes, Mano, Zeze, Welfare, Machado, and Bachi. In order to compete with Fluminense, three-time champions, and Flamengo, two-time champions, some thought what was needed was a team of whites. Miranda ended up leaving the team, and America won the championship of 1922 with a team of whites. It didn't matter that Miranda had played the whole first half of the season. The second half team is the one that won the championship. The one that was photographed as the champion of the centenary of Brazilian independence. This America's team, Ribas, Perez, Barata, Gonçalo, Osvaldo, Matasso, Justo, Gilberto, Chico, Simas, and Brilhante, was captured in a big frame to be hung in the hall without Miranda or Manteiga. But this was proof that soccer was a game of whites. No club with a mulatto or a black player on the team had won a championship from 1906 to 1922. Just the Brazilian side with Friedenreich. Friedenreich, however, had a German father and did not want to be a mulatto. Not even when whites were separated from blacks in order to see who played better. A side of whites was formed and a side of blacks and mulattoes, and Friedenreich was not picked by either of them. An homage paid to the author of the goal of Brazil's victory in 1919, neither white nor black, without color, above those things. It's true that it was recognized that mulattoes and blacks played just as well as whites. There were great players of color, much more than ever before. All one had to do was go to an empty lot or watch a small club game, and the black man could play on the Brazilian side, just as Gradim had played on the Uruguayan side. Tatu, South American champion of 1922, was not white. In fact, he was quite dark, with thick, curly hair. But the finer clubs did not even think of including them, at least Fluminense, Flamengo, and Botafogo. If America thought about them, it was because they were losing their patience with the years passing. 1917 through 1920, with no third championship. And in the end, they were champions in 1922 with only white players. Mulatto and black players were, in the eyes of the finer clubs, a kind of illegal arms like a revolver or a switchblade. If no big club pulled out their switchblade, the others could continue fighting with fencing foils. One second division club, however, rose to the first division. This club was called Vasco da Gama Regatta Club, and it brought with it mulatto and black players. Nelson Conceição, who had left Engenho de Dentro, mulatto. Cisse from Villa Isabel, almost black, and Nicolinho from Andarai, black. The other players were white, some barely knowing how to sign their names. Vasco, a club of the Portuguese community, was following the good Portuguese tradition of mixing. It had its issues in rowing, but in soccer it never did. Mixing right away. Also, when Lusitana merged with it, in order to enter the Metropolitan League, it brought two mulattoes with it, the Tavares brothers. And Lusitania was even more Portuguese than Vasco was. Brazilians could join Vasco, but not Lusitania, which was strictly Portuguese. It was an influence of the visit of the Lisbon side to Rio. Soon, three clubs emerged from the Portuguese community. Lusitania Esporte Club, Centro Português de Desportos, and Lusitano Fútbol Club. Lusitania adopted the jersey of the Lisbon side, a black cashmere shirt, on the shield the familial sphere and the arms of Portugal. Vasco's jersey would be black, Luzine, and white, Faustian, with the cross of Malta as its shield, to be worn by Portuguese and Brazilians, both whites and blacks. The Tavares brothers, Antonio Maratiero Faria, Alfredo Godao, Benedito Palhares, and Esquerdinha were mulattoes and blacks who Vasco kept picking up from the empty lots and the small clubs, already mature players. Vasco did not produce black players. For a black player to join Vasco, he had to already be a good player. Between a white and a black player, the two of similar quality, Vasco would stick with the white one. Black players were recruited out of necessity to help Vasco win. For this reason, the club went looking for Nelson's chauffeur, Conceição at Engenho de Dentro, for Nicolina at Andarai, for Ceci at Villa Isabel, and for Bolau at Bangu. Bolau was not from the fabric room. He did heavy work in the dye room. In his apron and tall boot-like clogs, in Vasco he could rise up the ranks, as there was no lack of Portuguese people wishing to help Vasco players. From Bangu also came Letao, a white man who had learned to play soccer in the church square. Many people up there still remembered the boy. His father had an ox cart, and Letao would go in front with a stick. All it took was for his father to get a little distracted. Letao would jump down from the cart and go running to kick the ball around with the other poor boys. Mingote, almost blonde, had come from Pereira Passos, a club in Saude. Pascoal, white, was from Rio de Janeiro. This was the same Pascoal who had only learned to sign his name when Horacio Werner arranged Silva for him, much easier than his original Italian surname. Antonio Campos paid for someone to teach him his ABCs. Since he did not want any trouble with the league making more and more demands, thinking that soccer players had to know how to read and write. Tortiroli of Benfica was white, as was Lindinho, the butterfly, of Botafogo, and Negrito of Lampa. Vasco had only one player produced out of their own system, Archer. For this very reason, he was white. No one gave any importance to Vasco's entry into the first division. What could a club from the second division do against an América, champion of the centenary, against a Flamengo, two-time champion, against a Fluminense, three-time champion? Vasco could place as many mulattoes and blacks as they liked on their team. Everything would continue on as before, the whites winning championships, the mulattoes and blacks in their place on the small clubs. Vasco was nothing different. A club with a little field on Moraes e Silva Street, which was not even sufficient for games of the first division. Meanwhile, Fluminense already had another stadium. América was building its own little stadium. Flamengo had its field on Paysandu Street, the shade of the palm trees lying across the lawn, and Botafogo had its General Severino field. They had everything, whereas Vasco had nothing, just the little field on Moraes e Silva Street, almost abandoned, a dormitory. When they woke up, the players would drink their café au lait, then go out for individual training, an individual session unlike any of the players of América, Flamengo, Fluminense, or Botafogo had done in all their lives. With Platero, cigar in mouth, setting the example, they would trot from the Moraes e Silva Street field to Plaza Sete, then turn around and go back. Afterward, they would go to the field and have a kick around for hours and hours, sometimes at night. If there was a moon, one could see the Vasco players on the field, training. They did nothing else. Platero's system was this: ball, ball, and more ball. The only exception was Nelson Conceição. Nelson Conceição could play at jumping up and down, on and off a chair, with his feet together, a good exercise for a keeper. When Vasco entered the field for a game, the maximum the other team could last would be one half. Vasco did not get worried if they lost the first half. The more the other team ran and sweat through their jerseys, the better it was for Vasco. In the second half, the players on the team would barely be able to stay on their feet, and the Vasco players seemed as if they hadn't even begun to play. The more Vasco won, the more the fields filled up. Even Fluminense's stadium was too small. People who had never attended a soccer match bought tickets to the grandstand, all Portuguese, who were obliged to go wherever Vasco went. While Vasco had been in the second division, there was none of this. Only the people in the old guard followed the team. Sinhao, always with a cigar in his mouth, always wearing white, stuttering cries of goal. Jose Ribeira da Pavia, who called Vasco Little Bearded One, after Admiral Vasco da Gama discovered of the route to the Indies, who had an impressive beard. Jose Ribeira de Pava would give those around him a little lesson in history. Narciso Bastos, the inventor of the goal whistle, he would blow his whistle before the referee, a different whistle for each kind of stoppage of the play. There was the whistle for a foul, for a handball, for out of bounds, for a corner, and for a penalty. The goal whistle was the most extravagant of all, the twitter of a nightingale. And Pascal Pontes, who invoked curses, and Vitorino Resende da Silva, who stopped talking to anyone for at least 3 days every time Vasco lost, and Paradanta, who would fight for Vasco at a game. And Antonio Campos, who always ended up crying whether Vasco won or lost. These days, no one could discern the old guard in the grandstand. They were there, but they were lost in the middle of a crowd of Portuguese, a crowd that would grow each Sunday, with Portuguese all over the place, because Vasco was winning. At first, it was even funny, nobody expecting anything, when a fan of Fluminense, Flamengo, America, or Botafogo would say, in falsetto, "Come on in, Vasco, my husband is a member." Many people were laughing, as if the joke paid for the defeat. It did not. Those who had found it funny were not laughing by the time they left. And later, it seemed as if there were only Portuguese drivers in the plaza, as they drove around honking, announcing another victory for Vasco. Another thing that announced a Vasco victory was the festive atmosphere at the breweries. Capello do Largo da Lampa and Cervejaria Vitoria da Praco Onze. Only Vasco fans and teams had the right to laugh and to beat the other steins on the iron tables there. The other clubs were thinking that this had to stop. It had become almost a question of national honor to defeat Vasco. Jacobinism in soccer, pitting Brazilians against Portuguese. The Portuguese were at fault. Little did it matter that the team of Vasco, with its whites, mulattoes, and blacks, was quintessentially Brazilian. The players of Moraes e Silva had lost their nationality and become Portuguese. This so that nobody could say the big clubs were against the small ones, against black players. They were against the Portuguese, who had altered the natural order of things. The poor people of the empty lots and the small clubs, whites, mulattoes, and blacks, were having their way with the big clubs, which consisted only of whites, fine society people. It was because of the Portuguese. If not the Portuguese, then how could those players who had never done a single thing now do something? Many did not know how to read or write, could barely sign their names, and were without jobs, without anything. The Portuguese were the ones who gave them everything, a home, food, and laundry washed and starched. They ate well and often, eggs with ham and eggnog early in the morning, after individual training. Then they lunched and dined at Filhos do Ciao. And they did not allow themselves the extravagances of Flamengo and Fluminense, staying late at Lamar, playing billiards, smoking nonstop, only getting to bed earlier on Saturdays when there was a game on Sunday. The Vasco players remained at Moraes e Silva like eternal high school students. There was a time for everybody to go out together, and Platero, cigar in his mouth, would keep them in sight. The Portuguese thought that any precaution was worth it. Their tranquility depended on Nelson Conceição, Nicolino, Bolao, and Sisa. It was not good even to talk about a defeat of Vasco. If Vasco were to lose, the Portuguese would feel badly. They wouldn't even be able to walk down the street in public. For this very reason, beyond a home, food, and clothes, washed and starched, the Portuguese would give money to the players of Moraes e Silva. The money was called a beast, because sometimes it was a dog, 5 mil-reis, sometimes a rabbit, 10 mil-reis, other times a turkey, 20 mil-reis, a rooster, 50 mil-reis, or a cow, 100. But it did not stop there. There were cows with one or two legs, according to the game. Against America, champion of the centenary, against Flamengo, two-time champion, against Fluminense, three-time champion, a cow with a leg was too little. Only one with two legs would do. The Portuguese did not meet a player on Vasco without putting their hands in their pockets. Take it, Nelson Conceição, so you won't swallow any goals. Take that there, Bolao. It's fair that you take yours, since you already gave me a lot of money by winning. The Portuguese had won money on the Vasco team, betting with the fans of Flamengo, Fluminense, América, and Botafogo. Admittedly, it had been some time since anyone bet against Vasco. To bet against Vasco was to lose money for sure, which did not prevent, quite the contrary, the Vascainos of the market from taking money from the other clubs, challenging everyone to put their hands in their pockets and pull out a leather wallet within which one could find, in their entirety, the fauna of the national treasury. One had only to hold out a bill, doubled over on the long side, and Portuguese would arrive on all sides, giving a goal advantage. The goal advantage served as bait. Many a fan of a big club fell because of a little goal advantage. But it was becoming even harder to find someone willing to bet against Vasco. But all of a sudden, everything changed. People started appearing at the market to put down money, and without a goal advantage, just 1-1. The Portuguese would twist their mustaches and say, "He who warns is a friend, son. I don't want your money." "But I want your money, Manuel." "Okay, okay, but don't regret it. Don't come back and cry tears at me." It was the week of Vasco and Flamengo transformed into an authentic Portugal versus Brazil. Every day, the newspapers were provoking Flamengo, as if Flamengo needed to be provoked. If someone from Vasco passed by Flamengo's garage early in the morning on the day of the game, they would have noticed some strange movement. The newsstands had received some big orders for the Journal do Brasil, all for Flamengo. In the back of the shed, the rowers wrapped up the oars in newspaper. Thus, the utility of the Journal do Brasil, the most voluminous paper of the era, the whole garage was working. Quadros, Geraldo Borges Letao, Caesar Lutterbacher, Arnaldo Costa, Placido Barbosa, Carlos Cruz, Everardo Cruz, Guilherme Geyer, Manuel Avernas, Paulo Nogueira, Analia, Fly, Jaguar, Chocolate, Moonduster, Foot in the Bottom, and Bat, ready to take control of the strategic positions in Fluminense's stadium, each one with his oar rolled in the Journal do Brasil. Before the beginning of the game, between the second teams, the police ordered that Fluminense's gate be closed. Not even a needle could fit in general admission in the grandstand on the track. The grandstand had grown, extending down to the track reaching to the edge of the field, encircled by iron bars. Even so, behind the goals, there was a neat little crowd, fans lying, sitting, squatting, one not wishing to block the view of the other. Never before, not even for the South American Championship of 1919, had a soccer game awoken such interest. More than 5,000 visitors came from different states, almost all of them with the Vasco shield on their shirts. They would be seeing soccer for the first time. Look, there, it's Nelson Conceição, man. Look there, Tortoroli, Vasco's coming in. It was enough to make the Flamengo fans push the Vasco fans right away, itching for a fight. The rowers were holding their oars, still containing themselves, as the order was to hit the Portuguese over the heads with the oars only after the game had begun. The Vasco team formed a close row, everyone standing, looking at the photographers. The only one who didn't look at the photographers was Nelson Conceição, with the ball cradled to his chest, very close to the Maltese cross. Flamengo posed like the Brazilian side of 1919, with many people saying it sufficed to see how the teams looked, took photographs to perceive quickly the differences between them, between Vasco and Flamengo, between a team of whites, mulattoes and blacks all mixed together, and a team of whites, of fine people from good families. And it was the team of mixture that was at the top of the championship without a loss. They had to lose, at least once, somehow. Flamengo had prepared all week for no other reason, training all day, going to bed early, putting the garage on a war footing. And when the game began, Flamengo took control of the field, of the grandstand, of general admission, of everything. Flamengo 1-0, oars wrapped in the Jornal de Brasil, beating the heads of Vascaínos. Flamengo 2-0. Again, the oars rising and falling. Whoever was for Vasco did not have the right to open their mouths. When the half ended, many people were really loving the score. Flamengo 2, Vasco 0. That is, the people from Flamengo, Fluminense, Botafogo, and América. Flamengo had ceased being a club, a team. That day, it was all the clubs, all the teams of Brazilian soccer. Everything was getting back on track. The best players were still white, the proof residing in that 2-0 score. The black players had no answer. And the Flamengo folks began to sing, "Let us salute Mina Guerra, the giant of the deep." There was not just one giant of the deep. Flamengo, too, was a giant of the deep. Flamengo, who makes me weep. The people of Vasco were quiet, waiting for the turn. The first corn is for the chicks. Just let Flamengo wait and see something. Sometimes Vasco would be getting creamed 3-0, and then they'd make a comeback, going on to win the game 4 or 5-3. That was the reason Platero took the players every day from Marais e Silva to Plaza Cité, there and back. The Flamengo team had killed itself on the field to score those two goals, while the team of Vasco allowed it, not getting worried, counting on the turn. The comeback had never failed, and it would not fail this time. It seemed that it would not fail, since the second half began with a goal from Vasco, and the Vascaínos were not able to yell, as a little shout would earn an oar to the head. Only Flamengo was shouting, and Flamengo ended up scoring another goal. And Vasco was still fighting. Flamengo 3-1. Flamengo 3-2. There was almost a tie. The ball entered, went out, and Carlito Rocha, the referee, was caught hesitating. Did it enter or not? And the game continued. Then the Vascaínos of general admission of the grandstand did not care any more about the oars on their heads. Whatever might happen, boos exploded here and there like popcorn. Soldiers came out with their sabers barred, running back and forth, and the cavalry invaded the field. It was no use to fight. Flamengo was going to win, whatever it cost. After the match, it was pitiful to see Fluminense's fields. The people had broken the iron fence, and the cavalry had filled the lawn with holes. Fluminense made a detailed account of everything, for the repair of the fence, for fixing up the field, which came to the total of 10 contos of reis. Vasco had to pay the 10 contos of reis. If not, they would never be allowed to play again in Fluminense's stadium. Despite there being no radio, all the city knew, almost in the same instant, that Vasco had lost. The automobiles had returned from Laranjeiras silent, without honking their horn or anything, like a funeral procession, carrying the fans of Vasco. The Flamengo fans went by foot to Paysandu Field, which was close by, almost in front of Fluminense, and to the garage a little farther, there on the beach. The garage filled up pretty quickly with people, and they decided to arrange a car with the top down and to look into buying fireworks from a spinner to a rocket. Each fan of Flamengo brought something. Chico Science, short and very thin with a round face, won the glory of the day by showing up with the biggest clog in the world, 2.5 meters in length, which was in permanent exhibition at a clog shop on Catete Street. It was agreed that the clog would go in the front car, a kind of chief car of carnivalesque procession. It was a second carnival. More than 100 cars paraded through the city, beginning at Flamengo Beach and moving to Gloria, then La Paz Square, stopping only to throw bombs at the chapel, then continuing on to Mem de Sas Avenue, Evaristo da Viega Street, Rio Branco Avenue, Larga Street, Republica Street Plaza, Vasconde de Ituana Street, and Plaza Onze, pausing once more to throw bombs at the Vitoria Brewery, where the Vascanas enjoyed celebrating their win. The Vitoria Brewery had to close quickly. The cherry bombs and rockets were slamming against the steel doors, then ricocheting. And the guy who was throwing the rockets was Placido Barbosa, the greatest sharpshooter in Rio de Janeiro, capable of making any order in a public plaza swallow an egg thrown from a distance of 10 meters. The parade continued all night long, and Flamengo celebrated its victory. And when they were about to end the parade, in the wee hours of the morning, they hung the clog of 2.5 meters on the door of Vasco's headquarters in Santa Luzia. They found this to be insufficient, so they brought an enormous funeral wreath in the flower market, which was placed alongside the clog, and, as if that weren't enough, they dressed the statue of Pedro Alvarez Cabral with clogs and strands of onions. But Vasco did not sit around with their arms crossed, so much so that on Tuesday the headquarters of Flamengo had been tarred from top to bottom. Crazy fans must have done it. Which club didn't have its crazy fans? Vasco would return the courtesies of Flamengo with flowers. They bought a giant corbeil, which barely fit in the car, with the top down, and took it to Flamengo. It was an interminable parade of automobiles, the Skynos on the side, footboards holding Roman candles, shaking torches and flags with the Maltese cross. The rowers of Flamengo locked the garage, and from the second floor received the committee from Vasco with a hail of stones. When they were no more stones, the rowers went up on the roof of the nuns' high school and stayed up there, throwing roof tiles down until the Vascainos went away. And for many days the commercial establishment of the Portuguese would hang a sign behind the counter talking about soccer is prohibited. To speak of soccer was to speak of Vasco's defeat. But another week went by, and Vasco continued to win and did not lose again through the end of the championship. The victory of Flamengo had given the illusion that everything would go back to the way it was before, the white teams winning championships, the black ones always losing. This illusion did not last long, and the fine clubs those of society, as they said, found themselves before a consummate fact. One did not just win championships with teams of whites. A team of whites, mulattoes and blacks, was the champion of the city. Against that team, the teams of whites had not been able to do a thing. The advantage of being a good family, of being a student, of being white had disappeared. The lad from a good family, a student, white, had to compete under equal conditions with the almost illiterate poor kid, the mulatto, and the black, to see who played better. It was a true revolution at work in Brazilian soccer. It remained to be seen what would be the reaction of the big clubs. Chapter 3. The Rebellion of the Black Man. Part 1. The reaction of the big clubs was tremendous. It had begun with the Vasco and Flamingo game of oars, clogs, ribbons of onion, cherry bombs, and rockets. It would continue in the Brazilian championship, a carioca side made of mostly of whites and two mulattoes, from Vasco, Nelson Conceição, from São Cristóvão, Nessie. Most of the white players were chosen from Fluminense, Flamengo, Botafogo, and América. The remaining white player, Nilo Martinho Braga, was from Sport Clube Brazil, with one foot in Fluminense. Even the whites of Vasco were pushed aside, as in the case of Pascoal, considered the best right-winger in the city. Between Pascoal, an ex-fishmonger who barely knew how to sign his name, and Zezé Guimarães, a young gentleman of society, it is clear that Zezé Guimarães was preferred. Vasco, the champion, gave one player to the side, Nelson Conceição, Botafogo, in last place gave two, Alemão and Palamone. For the side, the best players continued to be white and from good families. These players did not spend the whole day with the ball at their feet, as they had other things to do. Some of them worked. Some of them studied. There were those, of course, who did not work or study. They were the sons of rich daddies who had the luxury of doing nothing. The whites, mulattoes, and blacks of Vasco, coming from the empty lots and small clubs, could not allow themselves this luxury. The advantage had to lie with Zezé Guimarães, not with Pascoal Silva. What had happened in 1923 didn't need to happen again. Thus, Amia was born. The year 1924 saw the creation of Amia, a league of big clubs, without Vasco. It was not born sooner because Botafogo had been in last place and needed to play a relegation match. If not, it could be said that Amia had been founded in order for Botafogo to avoid relegation. After the relegation match, Amia would be founded, and never again would a big club go through what Fluminense had gone through, what Botafogo was about to go through. Botafogo thought it was unnecessary because there was no way they were going to stay in the Metropolitan League. They ended up playing and winning, and afterward there was a dinner at Sul America, Fluminense's restaurant for celebrations. The other clubs came to Botafogo's dinner, and it seemed as if Vasco was not the champion, that one of them had been the champion, one of the big clubs. It was not a new era that was beginning. Rather, it was the old era returning, the good times when white players were superior to black players, the good times of amateurism. Amateurism, or sport for sport's sake, was for those who were on top. While amateurism lasted, whites would be superior to blacks, the rich to the poor. Any poor black man who wished to compete with the whites, with the rich, would end up like Monteiro. If many white men, well-fed, with all the comforts of a home and a club, could not make it, How could a mulatto or a black man do so, having to work hard and to play soccer on top of that? The big clubs needed nothing else to make everything go back to the way it was before. Pure amateurism. Something for those living the good life. Whoever was not studying or working could not play. Whoever did not explain clearly how they made a living could not play. And even if they could clearly explain how they made a living, they could only play if they had a decent job. Subaltern employees were excluded. Was it amusing to have young men from good families go onto the field in order to be kicked by soldiers, sailors, and stevedores? Stevedores playing, that was why soccer was going backwards. An exception was granted for the factory worker. The factory worker could play, a move that shut the mouths of many. There were no castes in Amia. Bangu was small, and because it was small, and a club of the factory, it was the one chosen, so that no doubt would remain over the matter. This would show that the big clubs were with the small ones, the poor, the unprotected, the mulattoes and blacks. Fluminense brought Bangu by the hand to Amia, silencing all protest. No one had the right to say anything more. Here was Bangu together with the big clubs with the same rights. And the mulatto and black players could play, as they had always played, in the middle of the whites. They worked in the factory and only left the factory early on Thursdays. They did not spend the whole day kicking the ball around like Vasco's players. Bangu had never been a champion, while Vasco had been a champion right from the beginning. Bangu, besides the big clubs, would remain the same Bangu, of the factory, of the workers, without winning any championships. But Vasco had grown too much in 1 year. Shortly, it would have its own field, its own stadium, and then there would be no stopping it. But it did not yet have a field. It just had a club. Whoever did not have a good field with international proportions and with grandstands of cement like those of Fluminense and America, or of wood like those of Flamengo, Botafogo, and Bangu, could not belong to the group of so-called founders of AMIA, the masters of soccer. Each one had 5 votes, in addition to 1 vote for each sport it practiced. Fluminense, for example, was practicing almost all sports and had more votes than an entire division of small clubs. 8 clubs equaled 8 votes. Fluminense, with 5 votes as a founder and 1 vote for each track and field, basketball, volleyball, tennis, and shooting, had 10 votes. And the same, with small differences, went for the other founders. There were 5 founders, and the rest were simply affiliated members. With the founding of AMIA, the championship of 1923 was worth nothing to Vasco. The only thing that Vasco had now, beyond its fans, the biggest fan base yet seen on Carioca fields, was a team. The big clubs wanted Vasco to come to AMIA with its fans, with the Portuguese, with the Maltese cross on their chest. But they did not want Vasco to bring its team. For this reason, there was a commission of membership. Race, Carneiro of Fluminense, Dio Cesano, Dao, Ferrari, Gomez of Flamengo, and Armando de Paulo Freitas of America would go see if the players of Vasco, Nelson Conceição, Mingote, Balau, Pascoal, Tortoroli, and others worked, and if they did, whether they could live on what they earned. If they did not work, they would be cut. If they worked and earned little, an amount that would not suffice for the life they were living, they would be cut. And if they worked and earned a good living, they would still have to pass the terrible ABC test. The time of the player just knowing how to sign his name on the score sheet had ended. If he did not know how to write and read correctly and in the presence of someone like the president of the league, he would be cut. Many players who knew how to sign their names were perturbed, including Letao. When he was with Bangu, the league had no problem with him. But once he went to Vasco, he had to sign the enrollment form in front of Celio de Barros, then president of the Metropolitan League. Celio de Barros did not remove his eyes from Letao, and Letao got the cold sweats, feeling as if he were taking, if it were taking him forever to fill out the form. And he knew how to sign his name. He knew how to scratch out his letters. Every night, Custodio Mauro, a member of Vascao, would show up to Mareus e Silva for a calligraphy class. The most important thing was calligraphy. Custodio Mauro, at least, was not worried about anything else. If the player signed his name, everything was arranged. In those days, that was enough. A little before the game began, the referee would call over the players one by one, and the players would sign the score sheet and be done. But the league kept demanding more. The enrollment form became practically a basic reading and writing exam with a bunch of things to fill in. Full name, parents' name, nationality, birthplace, date of birth, where you work, where you study, and so on. Vasco thought Custodio Mauro's night class was too little, so they signed up Letao Pascal, Tortoroli, and Mingote in a school situated in a mansion on Quitanda Street. The players learned how to read by the João de Deus method, tracing verses from a primer. There went one day so small, round about Nazareth, in the company of St. Joseph, the Son of God of all, good Jesus, then whinging, he saw in the brush, come singing, terrified, a nightingale, which a serpent with flashing gaze, resplendent, sunlike and scheming, like a diamond gleaming, had attracted, wooed and charmed, praise wariness impacted, had Jesus alarmed, who left the path, kept bird unharmed, by breaking the charm. Reciting, it was easier to learn. Letao did not even look at the primer during lesson time. Da-dee-da, 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 the verses on the tip of his tongue. But even still, with two classes a day, one in the morning and one at night, he only barely passed the test of the enrollment form. Celio de Barros, on the request of Antonio Campos, stopped looking at Letao, but when he finished filling out the form, Letao confessed to Antonio Campos that he would rather play three halves in a row without break than go through such torture. During all of 1923, Vasco did not forget the ABC classes for the players. Naturally, those who did not need it were excused. Lindinho, son of a good family, who had been on America and Botafogo, Negrito, Arthur, Ceci, the cook, and Nelson Conceição, who, though he did not seem like it, knew how to read and write correctly. Bulao, who was bad at both reading and spelling, was improving bit by bit, like Pascoal. Pascoal was one of the ones who was most exemplary in calligraphy. He developed a nice round letter, very legible, even childlike, taking special care with the P and the S, for him the most important letters of the alphabet. Vasco in 1924 could rest easy with respect to the enrollment form test, at least the ones at Moraes e Silva, which the players passed every night. There was no shortage of enrollment forms there, just like the ones used by the league. Nor was it difficult for Vasco to employ its players. Any Vascaíno who owned a commercial establishment, whether large or small, liked the idea of having a Vasco player working for him. Vasco, however, feeling itself to be the size of Fluminense, Flamengo, América, and Botafogo, could not remain below Bangu like Andadai, Carioca, and Villa Isabel. The others with 5 votes, and it with only 1. The city champion with the vote of a small club, without the right to anything, it was better then to just stick with the small clubs once and for all with the black clubs. The distinction that was established between AMEA and the Metropolitan League was this. 1. A league of white clubs, the other, a league of whites, mulattoes, and blacks all mixed together. The separation came about naturally, and Adai could have gone to AMEA but preferred to remain in the Metropolitan with Vasco. Sport Club Brazil did not even discuss it. They had no black players on their team, so their place was in AMEA. It is true that Sao Cristóvão, with Nessie and Baininho, left the Metropolitan and went to AMEA to be small with 1 vote, but Sao Cristóvão would still argue for its right to 4 more votes. It had its field, its grandstands. If the question was one of a field or grandstand, Sao Cristóvão could be big like Bangu, not to mention the others. The Commission of Inquiry at AMEA, despite everything, went against Sao Cristóvão. Any club that had blacks would be under suspicion, except for Bangu, which set itself apart. Every player on Bangu wrote on the enrollment form, in the spot reserved for place of work, Industrial Progress Company of Brazil. It was not necessary to take the train and lose 3 hours on the round trip. The player might work in the fabric room, but he worked.
Context of White Supremacy. Live in Buffalo, the Katherine Massey Book Club. We will pause there. We actually made it to chapter 3. We are boogieing on through the text. We are slowly encroaching on the halfway point. Might actually be there by the time we are done today. We will pick back up right at the beginning of chapter 3. Here we're talking about the clubs with black players immediately under suspicion. All over the world, black get back. Once again, number is 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. The number again, 605-313-5164, the code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Kudos to our narrator again, super professional. I told her she's one of the few people that did know Gus T should be in Buffalo for the book club this week. So I told her and I said, I'm still planning to broadcast, so like normal, just letting her know in advance in case anything happens, because, you know, it'd be a lot more challenging for me having to fly across country and all the rest. Johnny on the spot. Excellent work from our narrator. Oh, the email I forgot. UntilJustice@gmail.com. UntilJustice@gmail.com. Drop us a line if you have thoughts on the black man in Brazilian soccer. All right, so I'll read one of our listeners who wrote in. Let's see, I came across an article online which may provide some additional analysis. The author of the article does resort to minimization of racism in Brazilian soccer, but I think the information provided is constructive. The beautiful game, question mark, race and class in Brazilian soccer, Rogério Dolphin and Teo Balve, September 25th, 2007, NACLA. I will investigate. By the folks, if they find it, think it's, you know, of value, let us know. White people in their ball games. Let's see. Chapter 2? Or wait a minute. Yes, Chapter 2. Number 1, page 104. Flamingo 2, Vasco 0. Soldiers came out with their sabers. Vasco had lost. Thank God that the dirty group of mulattoes and blacks did not win. They got to bring the soldiers out for a ball game? Are you serious? Is this malice at the palace? Although they do have many soccer games in Europe where they have to get the police out and all that. Sometimes the fanatic behavior is so bad that they have to end up clearing out the stadium, playing a game as punishment because of the hooliganism in the stands and racism. Number 2, page 106. Revolution at work in Brazilian soccer. It remained to be seen what would be the reaction of the big clubs. Revolution, more accurately, refinement. Great point. I think he wrote last week, we got a little bit ahead. He wrote about the metaphor calling black, mulatto, so-called non-white players switchblades and revolvers. And we comment like, what a violent metaphor and dehumanizing to refer to black people as these instruments of violence, right? Any hoodles, let's see. Trying to make sure we got the bar. Looks like, yes, we did get that far. Let me make sure. Yes. Page 107. The best players, white, good family, did not spend the day with a ball at their feet. Sons of rich daddies, all the talk of so-called good families is irritating. These good families, I am sure, were not about producing justice. This is slave culture. Like, their riches and all that, opulence and free time to be a doctor and study and play soccer, ball games and all that is off of enslaving, torturing black people, which again in Brazil, institutional rape of black males. Good family. Same page. 1923 didn't need to happen again. 1924, creation of AMEA. So they made a league to exclude Vasco because they were competitive with the mostly white clubs. That's what it seems like. Even all these, what do you want to call it, literacy tests? I mentioned that last week. I said that reminds me of the grandfather clause and poll taxes and all of that they had here in the U.S. Part of it was literacy tests. It was the same type of thing, so we can exclude these ignorant, dark people, right? And they would make the same thing. They would make excuses for poor white people who were illiterate. They would not be subjected to those draconian policies. He had already written about that before, Philo, where he had said that for the illiterate white players in Brazil, they would get tutors and all the rest, and they would, you know, get it so that they could do their name and all this. They're even refining the test to make it more. It started off, you just had to do your name. Now she got to give us a whole paragraph and we got to watch. Oh, let's see. What are you doing? Watch, you know, every stroke that you make with the pen. Like, dang. Or maybe they just do that for the narrows. Let's see. 108, page 108. The old era returning. Good times of amateurism. Bill Russell talked about that. While amateurism lasted, whites would be superior to blacks, rich to poor. So-called amateurism, I think, is just an excuse to exclude non-white players. I bet there was a lot of corruption in the so-called good old days of white amateurism in Brazilian sports. Bribes to players for changing teams, playoffs to referees, etc. U.S. Native American Jim Thorpe, who who is considered one of the greatest athletes of his era, had his 1912 Olympic medals taken due to making a few dollars playing baseball, effectively preventing him from participating in any additional Olympiads. See the 100 years dispute for Jim Thorpe's Olympic gold, New York Times, December 9, 2020. Woof, ongoing. Same page. Whoever did not explain how they made a living could not play. Subaltern employees excluded. There were no castes in EMEA. Reminds me of the vagrancy laws enacted after the Civil War to criminalize emancipated slaves. Subaltern was a term coined by Antonio Gramsci, describing the socioeconomic status of indigenous people in post-colonial countries. Case, The Origins of Our Discontent by Isabel Wilkerson. Cow's Book Club selection, another example of a book with a lot of confusion. I'm so disgusted. Isabel Wilkerson was supposed to be in Buffalo after the massacre to talk about Case. I have no idea why they invited her to talk about that book with the massacre. Warmth of Other Suns would have been much better for a billion different reasons, but either way, we read both those way back when. Today, when I was out talking with a white journalist about all of this, they had a flyer up, Isabel Wilkerson Case, right there. I don't know if she's supposed to be coming to Buffalo, maybe for Black History Month. We shall see. Page 109. If they did not work, they would be cut. If they worked, they'd have to pass a terrible ABC test. Did not know how to write and read correctly, and in the presence of the president of the league, they would be cut. What did I just say? Similar to the literacy tests used to prevent U.S. blacks from voting. Absolutely. Let's see. Page 111, distinction that was established between EMEA and the Metropolitan, the League of Whites, other leagues, mulattoes, and blacks all mixed together. The separation came about naturally. Commission of Inquiry of EMEA went against São Cristóvão. Any club that had blacks would be under suspicion. I'm puzzled by the selection. How can the separation among players occur naturally when you have a commission whose seemingly sole purpose is to police the participation of black players? See how soccer scandals tanked. National Obsession of Brazil, New York Times, March 24, 2001. Check that one out as well. I think that word tanked is in the word guide from Mr. Neely Fuller Jr. I think he recommends not using that term. Any hoodles? Let's see. I'll pause there. We'll get to the rest of it later. The number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Let's see. Lauren should be with us if you have commentary to share. Proceed.
Yes, sir. Thank you for letting me speak. At first, I thought this was just a kind of a history book about soccer. Now it seems like Mario Filho wrote this book because white people used to be the best soccer players, and he wasn't too happy about non-whites performing better than white players. On page 106, he said, the advantage of being of a good family, of being a student, of being white had disappeared. The lad from a good family, a student, white, and he repeated that. That's really weird that he repeated it that quickly. Had to compete under equal conditions with an almost illiterate poor kid, the mulatto and the black, to see who played better. I don't get that at all. He just listed all the advantages that white people had, and he used the term advantage. They had a good family. They're a student. They have education. They're able to eat. They have support, all sorts of things. They have more money. And even with all those advantages, when they lose the soccer game, they're saying they had to compete under equal conditions. That really confused me. And I think things have to be unequal for them to just feel, I don't know, better about themselves. Like, soon as it's like they're so angry that other people might do something better than they do. And that seems to be the case in a lot of different situations. I'm thinking about those Indians. And yeah, I don't know. I don't want to get off track, but that just seemed not to make sense to me. They are not competing under equal conditions. And page 109, this was already read, but it says, if they did not work, they would be cut. If they worked and earned little, if they worked and earned little, that would not suffice for the life they were living, they would be cut. And if they worked and earned a good living, they would still have to pass the terrible ABC test. Again, all these things seem really incorrect. And also, another line, it said, stevedores playing. Hold on. Was it amusing to have young men from good families go onto the field in order to be kicked by soldiers, sailors, and stevedores? Stevedores playing. That was why soccer was going backward. I wonder if he wanted to use another word besides stevedore. Like, it just sounded like stevedores was used in place of Negroes, and that's why soccer was going backwards. That's all I have for right now. Thank you for letting me speak.
Much obliged, Lauren. She said, she thinks Mario Filho wrote this because he had like a lament about black people, mulattoes, taking over soccer. She said, even if they could clearly explain how they made a living, they could only play if they had a decent job. Subaltern employees were excluded. Was it amusing to have young men from good families go onto the field in order to be kicked by soldiers, sailors, stevedores? I wonder if he had that alliteration in the original text. But okay, kicked by soldiers. Stevedores playing. That was why soccer was going backwards. She said maybe he didn't want to say stevedores. He wanted to say nigger. I don't know. Yikes. I'm going to have to think about it. Did anything else? Any other? It doesn't have to just be today. Like, we've read over a third of the books. I mean, that's enough to be able to, hey, I can make a, you know, more generalized assessment. Any other portions of the book made you think this is just the white man who is mad that niggers are taking over his ball game?
Gus, the title of the book.
Oh no.
I didn't get it at first. Like, when he said the black man in Brazilian soccer, I thought he was just talking about Pelé. And then I was really confused. I'm like, wait, they're not talking about Pelé. What is going on here? And now I think I get it.
So it's like the black man takes over. No. Oh. And that is kind of, Now we'll have to keep that in mind as we, that is what happened though. Like it is, I know like I'm not a soccer fan and all that, but Brazil, like the soccer team is super dark now. Yeah. And he watched all of that happen. Pelé being front and center way down the road. But even before that, obviously you had, I did say that. Why do we think he, so we think this is like a, oh man. Make Brazil great again. We got all these dark people that have taken over the good white man's game. Remember the good old days when it was just good white boys from good white families, and we didn't allow these old nigger boys and Gradims to come in here and mess up things, all these dirty nigger street urchins. Oh, it's just all gone to pot. Oh, at least we can reminisce. I have heard that before. I have heard that before. I have heard that a few times. We'll have to keep that in mind as we proceed. Much obliged, Lauren. Star 6-1. Other folks who have commentary. Let's see. I'll pick out some of the Isabel Wilkerson is scheduled to be in. she's scheduled to be in Buffalo in April to talk about her book Cased, which is painfully close to the one-year anniversary of the Tops shooting. Anyway, let's see. So we picked up 2.5. Lauren, she pointed out there are advantages to being classified as white anywhere in the world at any time period of white supremacy racism. So they're bragging again. About they get to eat really well. Now, we heard about black people in the favelas right now, right before the Olympics, and they were struggling to eat. Mahmoud Abdul-Rauf, we just read about that 2 times. And they're eating good steak, not just any steak, good steak and 2 fried eggs after a training session. Eating good. White man, anytime. Under the system of white supremacy racism, generally speaking, not always, but generally speaking, certainly doing better than the black people. And it continues talking about the food. And matter of fact, very next page, after that, it was time for brunch. The players could choose on the previous day the brunch menu, varying the food, preferring at times a hot chocolate with toast. We just talked all about that whole book, sugar, chocolate, all of that together sometimes. The obsession, Dr. Welsing talked about that, how many black people had to die, the cacao fields, sugarcane fields, South America, the Caribbean, white addiction to sugar and chocolate. Wealthy members with the will to feed the America team, even Florentino, owner of the Afonso Peanut Cafe, often the players would be eating a brunch, horse steaks, scrambled eggs with ham. Even what they're eating, man, like even right now, this is the sort of diet that they talk about right now and saying, hey, this is white people. Most non-white people in the world cannot afford to be sitting around and eating steak every day. Steak and eggs, like no way. Most non-white people can't even afford that, much less horse steaks or whatever else. Eggs, with the way inflation and eggs now, and ham. That is like a super white diet and is super unhealthy as well. But that is like most non-white people in the world. That's way outside of their price range. And all of that is really hard on the environment. All of that meat. And I mean, that's just meat, 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 meat. Like no veggies, no fruit, no nothing. Let's see. I think that might even qualify as sad. Standard American diet right there. Just need some cheese and Cheetos. And let's see. Oh, wait a minute. Let me get this in. He says, because, and I think this is a big part of it too, him lamenting that Negros have taken over soccer and minimizing the racism in Brazil. Because I think that's something white people do all the time. It's mandatory. Lying, deception. That's such a big part of how white people practice racism. He says, players would eat everything after an intense training session. There was no lack of appetite. It was these mornings when Miranda managed to forget that he was mulatto. What? He would laugh with the others at Chiquino's antics and enjoy his food as much as the others. But that forgetfulness was short lived. Now, I would pause even right there. Did you talk to Miranda? Did he write a journal? This is not footnoted. How do you know he forgot that he was non-white? Keep it real. Has anybody here, you forgot for a period that you were Negro, biracial, octoroon, whatever else, not white? Come on, man. Come on. As he would remember when he left for work and passed by America's Hall, he continued not showing up there even on days when he had to sleep at the club. The others went to the hall and stayed there chatting until bedtime, but not Miranda. Now, that's another one I would like to know. Why is this? He thought he was going to be mistreated. The homoeroticism. They made it know they didn't want him around. Like what? You'd have to give me some detail. And we keep hearing this about non-white players who are reluctant, where they just refuse to go hang out with their white teammates. They don't go drinking with them and all the rest of it. What is going on? Is this, like I said, is this they're not wanted? They've seen the racist antics. They don't want to hang out and be a part of all this drunken homo socialism, maybe even drunken homoeroticism. They want to miss all that. What's going on here? Even though, again, see, now I think that's about the third time that we've seen this with a non-white player. Nah, I don't do all that fraternizing with my teammates. Same thing I said last week. Counter-racist logic. Recognize counter-racist logic. Let's see. Oh, and we got the hair coming up again. When Montiega played for America, Miranda did not wear a cap. Now he started to wear a cap to hide his bad hair. That's another one I'd like to know. Is that what Philo, that's what he wrote in the Portuguese version? And so he got bad hair as it relates to non-white people all over the world. If it's kinky, if it's nappy, if it's not chemically mutilated, oh, you got bad hair. Ugh. Shame on you, and I feel sorry for you. You can say that in Portuguese, Spanish, English, French, bad hair. Oof, you ought to get rid of it. Oof. But he said color, hey, we don't have racism here. And to have to keep hearing this over and over, we got the hair that's got to be combed and beaten and lassoed and whipped and covered up and shaved off. Nigger hair, I guess. He says with a cap, he could pass for a bit browner than the other, showing his little bit of race. What? But without drawing much attention, he did not want to draw attention, which is why he put the cap on his head. So he didn't want to be mistreated, is what it sounds like. Anything that I can do, if I can just get by, make they accept me as white so I'm not mistreated, let's do that. Cut my anything to distract attention. Hey, you got one of them Gradims out there. Let's kick him. Beat him. Let's see. He said, oh, when we heard about, he says, because he mentioned Friedenreich before. This is a non-white player with a white parent, German parent. I even talked about that because he would identify German white dad. He would just say black father. They don't get a geographic location. Is this a Brazilian slave? African? What? What are we talking about? Who knows? Who cares? Negro, slave. Nah. Rape. He says with Friedenreich, he's another one. He talked all that detail about the hair. Got to be tamed and all that. Friedenreich, however, had a German father and did not want to be a mulatto. Why do you think that is? You old Brazilian sellout? What that is in Portuguese? Sellout? You sellout? You don't want to be black? But you be proud. Black and proud. That's what Jim Jones said. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Do I have the sound clip? I would have been playing this the entire 14 years we were on the air. Guyana is right next to Brazil in South America.
Are we black proud?
That's Jim Jones. That's Jim Jones in Guyana, South America, the day that he killed nearly 1,000 people, 75% of them approximately black. He asked his congregation, are we black proud? As a part of his request to ask them to drink suicide and self-terminate, forcing some of them to do so, and killing, I think, about 300 children, many of them black too. black and proud, even in South America. He said, a side of whites was formed and a side of blacks and mulattoes. See, I keep saying that he makes a distinction between black people and so-called mulattoes. I say that white people make a distinction. They have a hierarchy. You have a white parent. You're still a victim. You're still going to be terrorized. But, oh, yeah, well, you won't be treated as bad as the really dark people. Darker you are, the worse you're going to be treated. They have lots of data on that, and I think we're seeing it in this book. Just then, he's making a clean distinction so consistently. He could be saying non-white people or people of color. They got lots of terms that would indicate that. He does not do that. He employs the extra terms, black and mulatto and black, consistently throughout this text. And I've said even though you can look at the way the black people and mulattoes are talked about and treated, it's starkly different. Anyway, he says, the side of whites was formed, the side of blacks and mulattoes, and Friedenreich was not picked by either of them, an homage paid to the author of the goal of Brazil's victory in 1919, neither white nor black, without color, right? Above those things, he keeps saying those, and all of that, in my view, is confusion, minimizing white supremacy racism. He's not white, period. You got a system of racism, white supremacy, he's not white. White people obviously have seen that. Look kind of hair. He's up, got all that nappy, kinky, bad hair. Get out of here. You can say whatever you want to about the non-white people. They think he's a sellout, coon, whatever, blah, blah, blah. How do you say that in Portuguese? Non-white victim of racism and product of rape. Continuing above it. Come on. He wouldn't be hiding his flipping hair if he was above race. Oh, excuse me. That was our previous fellow. This is the one who said he did not want to be mulatto. We wouldn't even have to worry about that. He would just be a person on the planet, moving in a just world. He wouldn't be all this, whoa, I got to worry about my hair, and I got to dress right and hope everybody doesn't think I'm too dark. Come on, come on. And then to lie and say he's above race, come on. Let's see, he says, so you got more players, non-white players coming. Player of color, he says it right there. All one had to do was go to an empty lot or watch a small club game, and a black man could play on the Brazilian side just as Gradim had played on the Uruguayan side. Tattoo, South American champion of 1922, was not white. In fact, he was quite dark with thick, curly hair, presumably bad, Satanist, devil, evil locks of hair on his niggardly head. And even that right there said he was not white, period. We don't even need a classification on that. Mulatto, octoroon, quadroon, black, mestizo, not white and quite dark, so you know he's going to be mistreated. Yeah. And again, why would that even matter? If everybody can rise above color, if they're talented, why would it matter that he's quite dark and got bad hair too? Mulatto and black players were, in the eyes of the finer clubs, a kind of illegal arms, like a revolver or a switchblade. I mentioned that metaphor. We talked about that. I think one of our investors last week talked about that one. Let's see. This club, one second division club, however, rose to the first division. This club was called Vasco da Gama Regatta Club, and it brought with it a mulatto and black players. Nelson Consecao, who left Engejo Dendentro Mulatto, Cici from Vila Isabel, almost black. And you keep getting this, like, these really dark, almost black, you know. What? I don't even know what that means. Like, do you mean this person was highly melanated? I don't even know what to classify that. Almost black? What does that mean? What does that mean? Do you have almost white? Almost black? Almost mulatto? Almost mestizo? He said that before. Like, come, that's another classification. We got to add almost to all the classifications. Right on the teaspoon of being biracial, like, let's see. The Negroes are just out on the empty lots. Like, something about that just seems so niggardly and street urchin. Like, not at the school or the university, just wherever you go out in the empty trash heap junkyard, and there they go. Next star, which is kind of what they do here in the U.S. for basketball and tackle football with brain damage. Vasco did not produce black players for a black player. And even right there, because he didn't say mulattoes, right? He didn't say blacks and mulattoes, so maybe they produce mulatto players. You don't have to be already exemplary to be a footballer if you're mulatto. But if black get back, if you are black, you had to already be a good player. Between a white and a black player, the two of similar quality, Vasco would stick with the white one. Black players were recruited out of necessity to help Vasco win. That's why I said he didn't say it. Nowhere through there did he say black and mulatto, people of color, just black people. Let's see. And again, I think all this having to work at the factory and then play soccer, all of that is like some sharecropper setup that they have here in the U.S. during the same time period, because they say that Nelson Chauffeur, what a name, Consacao at English de Dentro for Nicolini and Andra for CC at Villa Isabel and for Bilal at Bangu. Bilal was not from the fabric room. He did work heavy work in the dye room in his apron and tall boot-like clogs. They said he did heavy work. He wasn't in the factory room. We heard about that before. You just can do slow foldings. You have to conserve. You can conserve your energy. Don't get hurt. Just sit down, chill out. Light work, as they call it. We heard about this. This dye was so bad it would burn your feet and all that. Imagine you got to breathe all that in. That's what I said, because they already said that. They had a number of soccer players. They didn't get an easy time. They had to go in there and do hard, arduous labor and then come out and go play soccer too. I said, that's what sharecropping, nigger work. I'm real familiar with all this. Chicken George is in Roots, right? Let's see. Mingoat was almost blonde. See, you got all this almost black, almost white, almost blonde. What is all that? Almost British. Shout out to Nairobi Thompson. Hey, what is all this? Either you're white or you're not. And what does it matter that you're almost blonde if color doesn't matter? Like, we made all this progress and revolution and everything. What is all? What, all the hair focus is just staggering. That's been from page one all the way throughout. We got in for males, all this focus from Mr. Fuller talked about that. When you're a male and you start progressing, you got to spend all this time and focus on your hair. What are you going to do with it? How are we going to tame it? And is it too curly? And over here, he said, you are gradually being more feminine, female. That's not manly, just to be sitting around and, what's my hair doing? What's my hair doing? Can I cover it up? What's my hair doing? What's my hair doing? Can I groom my hair? Can I do it? That's being a man. Let's see. So Vasco gets the reputation. They have all the Negros, non-white players. Even this is during the period when the white teams with all white players are still winning and have all the advantages and what have you, even though that's starting to change. Let's see. Even all this is bizarre. They blame the Portuguese and say it's their fault for disrupting the natural order of things and allowing all these Negros, non-white players, to come in and beat white teams, compete against white players, so they blame it on them. It becomes Brazil against the Portuguese. Now, even that is bizarre, at least in my view. Let's see. Yeah, he says the poor people of the empty lots and the small clubs, whites, mulattoes, and blacks, distinction, were having their way with the big clubs, which consisted of only whites, fine society people. It was because of the Portuguese, if not the Portuguese, then how could those players who had never done a single thing now do something? And it's almost even like these non-white players, they're not skilled, they're not intelligent, they could not learn this game and come and compete with us, even though we've mistreated and terrorized them to keep them from having resources and keep them illiterate. It's these white Portuguese people's fault for allowing all of this. It's like non-white people can never be in charge. Some white person had to come and give you this idea and orchestrate all of this. Same thing they said about the so-called civil rights movement here in the U.S. He says the white clubs, Flamingo, Fluminense, they would lounge around at the like ball club houses, frat house type of setup, playing billiards, smoking nonstop. ISIS papers, again, Dr. Welsing writes about all of that, white ball games, and even the symbolism of smoking cigars, especially brown, thick cigars, phallic symbol, especially with all the homoeroticism in this text. Speaking of, and them bringing the oars to the games, I think Dr. Welsing would see a lot of phallic symbolism in that as well. Why are you bringing oars? I'll stop. Much less that's a weapon too, but still. Anything else? The soldiers, there's so much violence at the game. They go out to beat people up afterwards. They threaten to beat the black players up during. They are beating on the black players. He said that last week, and they had better not retaliate, you know, or do anything other than smile and endure it pleasantly. But there's so much violence, the alcohol too, but there's so much violence around all the white ball games, you know. Oh, and they said Vasco did not sit around with their arms crossed. This is after they had lost to the white ball club. Flamingo is celebrating their victory over the Negra team, basically the white squad Flamingo. It says Vasco did not sit around with their arms crossed, so much so that on Tuesday the headquarters of Flamingo had been tarred from top to bottom. Crazy fans must have done it. Which club didn't have its crazy fans? Even, again, now, before we had the rice powder, right? Even the insults and everything, racist. Rice powder, coal dust. Remember they've said that before? And then they go and tar the facility. That, I think, is standard. Them tarring people sometimes. I think this is the first time that I've heard of a building being tarred, blackened, if you will. But, come on. And the fanatic behavior that is so common with white ball games. Let's see. Backwards because we got Negra involvement. Moving into chapter 3. And then they are teaching all of this about the literacy. I think everybody touched on that. They're using this primer that seems like it's all the religion of white supremacy, racism, and white Jesus, and all of that, even seeming like Christmas. We just passed that holiday. But that's what they're using to learn that is so common. The accoutrement of white supremacy is just, it's omnipotent in the system. That's how we learn to read here. Jane and Spot and the white family, white picket fence, and Romulus and Remus, and some ISIS papers too with the dog, and white people's relationship to that. But let's see. I think I can pause there. If other folks have commentary, you can email. So untiljustice@gmail.com if you have written commentary, and then *61 if you have commentary via phone line. If you want to write down anything from the first section of the reading, anything stood out, make a note. We should have ample time once the second section concludes. I have already made a number of observations in terms of just major trends. Now we have another one. So Lauren, she said she thinks that this book is kind of Philo's lament. Negroes are ruining our game. Back in the good old days, it was all white. Now look at this. You've heard that again, right? Make Brazil great again. I'm saying there's a distinction in how the black players are talked about and how so-called mulattoes are talked about. And I'm saying the so-called mulattoes are being feminized consistently in how they are described. The word choice, focus on hair and all the other things. Those are some, the absence of females. That's carried through this week. We still don't have them. They don't even get a name, right? Where are they? They're just a quick ornament and then back to the men. Yes, they were in tight pants and their hair and all the rest of it. Like, come on. Come on. And their big bulging muscles and their quadriceps. And homoeroticism in South America. Anywho, we will resume in chapter 3, the Katherine Massey Book Club, live in Buffalo. Second audio installment, The Black Man in Brazilian Soccer. Here we go.
By Ninho, however, a black man had written in the place of work, blank, S. Berard Factory, a glass factory in São Cristóvão, Reis Carneiro, Diocesano Ferreira Gomez, and Armando de Paula Freitas showed up at S. Berard Factory and made a point of seeing Baianinho working. Bayaninho worked as a blower, and the heat was so intense in the blower's room that the three commissioners came and went quickly, convinced. Bayaninho was not the only black player on São Cristóvão. There was also Nessie, who said he worked at Simoes, an herbal medicine establishment on Maranhiro's bridge. Nessie, however, was not found. Simoes reported that he had gone out on an errand. The Commission of Inquiry did not believe that story, so Nessie could not play. It was also necessary for the commission to inquire about some white players. If not, it would seem clear that Amia was truly against black players. As a result, the commission discovered that Osvaldo Manuver Gomez de Castro did not work, nor did his brother, Valdemar Afonso de Castro. Manuver, a player on the first team, and Valdemar, a player on the second team, were both cut. Amadeu Macedo, president of São Cristóvão, protested, asking if Amia did not believe his word. He had signed the enrollment form, giving his word that what the player had written was the expression of truth, and then a commission of inquiry had come and said that he had lied, or close enough to it. São Cristóvão requested a new inquiry for Nessie. For the others, it was not necessary. Manuver and Valdemar did not work, as their fathers were the owner of a business hall in Cancela Square, and supported his sons, as did many fathers of players, on Fluminense, Flamengo, América, and Botafogo. Amea had to apologize to São Cristóvão. They did not even order a new inquiry. The word of Amadeu Macedo was enough. Why argue over the situation of one player? And afterward, everything went so well. The good times really had returned. One barely saw any black players on Amaya teams. Of Fluminense, Flamengo, América, Botafogo, Bangu, São Cristóvão, Hellenico, and Sport Clube Brasil, only Bangu and São Cristóvão had some mulattoes and blacks. Hellenico wanted to be the suburban Fluminense. They did not allow black players on the team, just like Sport Clube Brasil. The proof that 1919 had returned was Fluminense. Fluminense was winning game after game, marching toward winning a championship. Geraldo, Petit, Leo, Nascimento, Floriano, Fortes, Zize, Lagarto, Nilo, Coelho, and Mauro Costa, one could recite the 1924 Fluminense team as one had recited that of 1919. To see that everything was right. The Fluminense team was right, and Amea was right. It was something else to play like that, white with white. Now it was a pleasure to prepare for the games. The Fluminense players even trained more. Almost all of them slept at the club. Only Leo and Coelho of the Naval War School and Nascimento, who never got used to all the noise of the Fluminense dormitory, with the players playing around and throwing pillows at one another, were not obligated to sleep at the club. Bedtime was at 11. It had originally been 10 o'clock, but the players thought it was too early, since 10 was when Lamas was getting good. Even so, there were those who would arrive later, when the gate was locked, and the guard had orders to shoot if he saw someone jumping the wall. Fortes would almost always jump the wall. One early morning, the guard, thinking it was a thief, fired a shot. Fortes raised his hand and yelled, "It's me!" Fortunately, the guard had fired into the air as a warning shot. After that, before getting to the wall, Fortes would start whistling from the sidewalk. Unless he received a responding whistle, he did not risk going over. The guard was on orders to shoot at whoever it might be, even at a player like Fortes. If he could not or did not want to arrive on time, then let Fortes sleep at his own home like Nascimento. Nascimento slept at his house and lived in Tijuca. Even so, by the time the other players woke up, he had already jumped rope and finished doing his laps. If he were to wait for the others, he would get to Sucre, Brazil, late, which was where he worked. Moura Costa would almost always keep Nascimento company. He, too, had to go to work early, not as early as Nascimento, but if he didn't train with him, he would end up training alone. It was difficult to get Harold, Fortes, Floriano, Petit, Zeze, Lagarto, and Nilo out of bed, since all of them had plenty of free time. Further, Maura Costa had no beef with Nascimento, whereas the other players played jokes on him, dressing themselves up as ghosts to scare him. If there was one thing that Maura Costa was afraid of, it was ghosts, and the ghosts would appear in the Fluminense dormitory, white sheets walking, while Maura Costa shut his eyes and covered his ears, wishing neither to see nor to hear. At one point, he had even fainted. It was late and dark, and he didn't want to turn on the light and wake anyone up. He ran into welfare, thought he was a ghost, and fell backwards, passing out. So that this would not happen again, Maura Costa would go to the club early, while everything was lit and there were no ghosts, and go to sleep before they turned out the lights, then wake with the birds. The others got up only when Charles William showed up to pull them out of bed. From the dormitory, they would go to the field while Charles William ordered their breakfast, milk, coffee, Petropolis toast, ham and eggs, and even filet mignon for those who wanted it. First, there was French gymnastics, the players opening and closing their arms, breathing deeply. They were just beginning, and Nascimento and Mauro Costa would appear, already dressed and on their way to work. Zeze Guimarães made fun of them. He had not lost the habit of calling every player who worked a slave. Nobody from Vasco was near, so Zeze Guimarães could joke about Nascimento, Maura Costa, and welfare, though welfare did not play anymore. Fluminense had gone to Bahia and was considered an official guest. Every day, the newspapers of Boa Terra published the list of players, which did not prevent Popo, a gigantic black man with crooked legs, from kicking welfare right in the knee. Though Mr. Welfare had stopped playing, he continued sleeping at Fluminense, living the same life as those who did play. He liked that life. Llamas, the Matriz da Gloria staircase, the dormitory with its pillow fights and its ghosts. The ghosts did not drag the sheets through the halls of Fluminense, only to scare Maura Costa. Sometimes they would dress up like ghosts and go to the club's bar, like after that, St. John's party. Fluminense had prepared a bonfire, and the players ended up setting off rockets deep into the night. Then, bedtime came and no one was sleepy. Fortes dressed up as a ghost in front of Maura Costa, so Maura Costa would not be afraid. About three ghosts went to the bar and returned carrying bottles of vermouth, gin, and whiskey. Welfare ended up with a bottle of whiskey just for him. Other ghosts brought glasses and bottles of soda and mineral water. They drank until the early morning. If not for welfare, the empty bottles and glasses would have remained in the dormitory, and when Charles William appeared to pull the players out of bed, he would have discovered everything. Welfare had drunk more than anyone else, but he was English, and he never lost his perspective on things. It was necessary to return the empty bottles and the cups to the shelves of the bar. For Eugenio, who managed the bar, it was hard to believe that there was not one drop of vermouth, gin, or whiskey in those bottles, which were arranged perfectly, each bottle in its place. Eugenio did not complain to Fluminense. Instead, He took Fortes to the side and presented the bill, almost 800 milreis. So many bottles of soda and mineral water, so many bottles of vermouth, gin, and whiskey. That total had to be correct. Eugenio was a good man and would never exploit anyone. Fortes took up a collection among the players who had drunk and even arranged a good tip for Eugenio. Eugenio had behaved like a gentleman. It was not without reason that he had taken over Fluminense's bar. Fluminense knew whom to choose, even to take over the bar. The players of Fluminense had never had it so good. The director of soccer was Ramiro Pedrosa, a millionaire with an open hand. He kept inventing things to please the players. Luncheons, dinners, outings, presents. Nilo Martinho Braga, the top scorer of the championship, and Floriano Peixoto Correa, the marshal of victory, received presents every week. But then Floriano Peixoto Correa went so far as to exploit Ramiro Pedrosa. Sometimes he would be in the city on a training season day, a training session day, and he would call Ramiro Pedrosa apologizing. He was not going to arrive in time to train. Ramiro Pedrosa would ask where he was, and he would respond that he was in Petropolis. Ramiro Pedrosa would instruct him to take a taxi and come running. Floriano Peixoto Correa would wait a while, calculating the time it would take for a taxi to quickly go from Petropolis to Rio. When he finally jumped out of the car, the doorman of Fluminense would already be on the sidewalk with 500 milreis. So much was not necessary, so Floriano Peixoto Correa would put 300 milreis in his pocket and return 200 to Ramiro Pedrosa. The change, Mr. Ramiro. Ramiro Pedrosa did not even look at the change. He simply hurried the marshal of victory along. Practice had already begun, and Floriano Peixoto Correa needed to change clothes. After the training session, Ramiro Pedrosa would take the players to the Toscana, and he almost always had a bunch of theater tickets in his pocket. For the São José, the São Pedro, the Trianon, the Republica, the Lirico, or the Municipal. When there was a lyrical performance, Ramiro Pedrosa made a point of the Fluminense players wearing their tuxedos. Moura Costa, who was from a very good family but poor, did not have a tuxedo. To conceal this, he would give an excuse that he needed to see his fiancée and he would not go. Ramiro Pedrosa ended up discovering everything when Fluminense was preparing to go to Sao Paulo. The first thing that the players of Fluminense packed in their bags was their tuxedos, the tuxedos being as important as their cleats, shorts, and jersey. Fluminense would take care of bringing the sporting material. All the players needed to concern themselves with was their clothes for outings and parties. Moura Costa packed pajamas, two shirts, three pairs of underwear, and three pairs of socks in his suitcase. No tuxedo. Ramiro Pedrosa did not waste any time. He took Mauro Costa to a good tailor. The tailor was told to arrange a tuxedo immediately for Mauro Costa, whatever the cost. Ramiro Pedrosa would not agree about the price, would not argue about the price. Thus, Mauro Costa managed to appear in a tuxedo at the banquet of Polistano for Fluminense. All the players of Fluminense, those who had played and those who hadn't, were in tuxedos. It's true that they could not be outdone at Polistano. The players of Fluminense, however, did not just wear tuxedos on the night of a party. They were staying at the Esplanada, and when they came down to dinner, 20 young men, all together in tuxedos, they drew the attention of the guests, and the guests were accustomed to such things. And if that wasn't enough to call one's attention, There was the table prepared as a banquet, decorated with flowers. It became obligatory to ask who those young men were, so pleasant, so personable, so elegant, who were fine dining every night. The shock increased when one discovered that these young men were soccer players. The popularity of soccer had given many people the impression that the time of the player in a tuxedo was long gone and definitively in the past. The newspapers were already printing columns on players who had never worn tuxedos in their lives, people of the lower class who barely knew how to read and write, players with just one name or even just a nickname. But in the end, Fluminense had not changed. The proof was there. It remained to be seen whether these young lads, who were so pleasant, elegant, and fine, played soccer like the others, those with just one name or a nickname. They did indeed play like the others, if not better. The Fluminense team was the Carioca champion. The Amea side was the Brazilian champion. Fluminense had given five players to the side: Geraldo, Fortes, Zeze, Lagarto, and Nilo. Flamengo had given four: Penaforte, Cibra, Nono, and Moderato. And Sport Club Brazil and São Cristóvão had each given one: Ribeiro and Nessi, respectively. Summing it all up, 10 whites and one mulatto. Chapter 3, Part 2. And if the side had been all white, it would have been all the better. Say Nascimento in place of Nessi. Still, it did no harm to have a mulatto on the side. On the contrary, it served to show that Amea was not as much against black players as it seemed. The demonstration had been given, and it was a success. It had been necessary for Amea to arise, ending the story of the small club being equal to the big club, the black men equal to the white, for the Carioca side to win a Brazilian championship. The players from good families had a new lease on life. They could live the life they had been living without the danger of competing in inferior conditions with the poor whites, mulattoes, and blacks. Amea was there to assure that the poor whites, mulattoes, and blacks would not be allowed to spend the entire day on the field kicking the ball around. For this reason, it was even good that Vasco was joining Amea. Amea needed a club with an immigrant community. It needed one so much that it had even allowed Sirio to join. But the Turks did not like soccer like the Portuguese did. If Vasco were to join Amea, there would be no field that had enough room. All of them would be bursting at the seams with people. And Vasco would never lift the championship cup. How could they win the championship if their players had to work, doing the hard stuff? And then there was the commission of inquiry, which would not leave Vasco in peace. Once in a while, without notice and at random times, the commission of inquiry would appear at Moraes e Silva to see if a Vasco player was around. With Vasco in Amea, the commission of inquiry would work every day, going to Moraes e Silva and to the commercial establishments where Vasco said their players were working. Nobody believed that Vasco's players were actually working. The commission of inquiry was certain that the Vasco players were on the employee rolls of the commercial establishments just for show. Maybe many Portuguese owners of commercial establishment thought it was not necessary for the players to actually be working, that it sufficed simply to say they did when they came asking about a particular player.
"Yes, Paulo works here, sir. He's a great employee. I give you my word."
The commission of inquiry had a trick. They did not ask for the player. They asked for the employee. "Does Mr. Nelson Conceição work here?" And Nelson Conceição did work there. He happened to be at the front counter of Casa Portela.
But Nelson Conceicao was known as Nelson Conceicao. Espanhol, however, had the name Francisco Goncalves. In the leather shop of Mr. Gomez Portela, the commission of inquiry asked after Francisco Goncalves. Francisco Goncalves did not work there. Espanhol, in truth, did not work anywhere. Vasco would arrange him a job after job until they could prove that he had a position, but Bilal worked at the Buttons and Metal Artifacts Factory Company. He worked in shipping and packaging. If the commission of inquiry went to the shipping room, they would find Bilal working without stop. Bilal wanted to make something of himself in life. He knew that soccer would end for him sooner or later, and was thinking of the future. The commission of inquiry did not ask for Bilal. Instead, they asked for Claudinor Correa. Claudinor Correa? There must have been some mistake. No employee of that name worked at the Buttons and Metal Artifacts Factory Company. Everybody there knew Claudinor Correa as Bilal. Bilal here and Bilal there. At times, all that was required was a last name to confuse the boss of a Vasco player. For example, Silva de Pascual. If the commission of inquiry asked for Pascual, Mr. Figueiredo, the owner of Casa Verde on Senador Eusebio Street, would not hesitate a moment, but Pascual Silva, who was Pascual Silva? And every Sunday, Mr. Figueiredo would cheer for Pascual from the grandstands. Come on, Pascual, bring in Pascual. If such a thing happened with Pascual, imagine what would happen with Negrito when the commissioners asked if Mr. Alipio Martins worked there. It was a good idea on the part of the commissioners to consult the aliases of the player. Perhaps there was an Alipio Martins. There is no Alipio Martins, no sir. It was amusing that their boss did not know the names of his employees. Ah, so Negrito doesn't really work here? Negrito? Negrito is my employee, one with his hands full. Ah, if only they were all like Negrito. When with Cese, it was the same thing. He was called Silvio Moreira. His boss did not even know this. He had hired Cese, the little black guy who played left midfield for Vasco. The commission of inquiry did not even argue. They cut Cese, as they had cut Espanhol, Bilal, Pascual, and Negrito. As they were going to cut Artur, Rosenho, Brilhante, and Migote.
The Katherine Massey Book Club Context of White Supremacy Live in Buffalo. Alrighty, we will pick up Chapter 3 for next Thursday. Might still be in Buffalo at that time. We shall see. Number is 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943 pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Email is untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. Alrighty, let us see. I'll switch it up. I'll check, see Lauren, any of the other folks who dialed in, if y'all have commentary. Then I'll get our emails, give my own commentary, and that should do us for our study session this here week. Let's see. Lauren should be with us. I'll nab other folks if they have hands up commentary to share. Anything stand out significant from the second portion of the reading? nothing stood out from audio segment two. Or I'll check in, I'll do some of the emails, and then we'll check.
Can you hear me?
Oh, there she is. Mute button might have got her too. Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
Yes, okay. It said any club, well, it was talking about the Commission of Inquiry of EMEA, and it said any club that had blacks would be under suspicion, except for Bangu, which set itself apart. And that's the factory one, I think. But then, so they go to check on the Negroes to make sure they're at work. And Baina Niho, I'm not sure if I'm saying that correctly, he works at the glass factory. He's in there blowing glass, and they're like, oh, okay, he's at work. Then they go to the pharmacy, and the Negro who works there is out running errands. His name is Nessie. And since he wasn't at work at the exact time they went by there, they just decided they would cut him. And then it said it was also necessary for the commission to inquire about some white players. If not, it would seem clear that EMEA was truly against black players. As a result, the commission discovered that, well, I don't want to say all those names, but four white people didn't have jobs. And so then they got cut. I thought that was pretty ironic. And it turned out that the black guy really was running errands or whatever. He had a job, so they let him play again. And I think it was because a white man, went and talked to him and was angry that they did that. Later on page 112, it said one could recite the 1924 Fluminense team as one had recited that of 1919. To see that everything was right. The Fluminense team was right, and EMEA was right. And EMEA is the council going, you know, making it hard for the Negroes. And I think also he said right like three times in a row. I think that was his way of saying white without saying white. And also right after he said it was something else to play like that, white with white. Now it was a pleasure to prepare for the games, I guess, since they didn't have to play with any Negroes. Let me see. Okay. On page 116, it said, but in the end, Fluminense had not changed. The proof was there. It remained to be seen whether these young lads who were so pleasant, elegant and fine, played soccer like the others, those with just one name or a nickname. Pelé had one name, Montero had one name, Montiga, and Gradim. So it's clear they're talking about non-white people. And that's all I have for now.
Much obliged, Lauren. The nicknames for the black people, even that, I'm going to pay attention if I see the mulattoes get these bizarre nicknames and such as we kind of move on through the text here. Much obliged, Lauren. Let's see. I'll do it the order I said. So phone calls, other folks, *61 if you have commentary, and then I'll get the emails. So one of our investors who wrote in, I was reading his email previously. I'm picking back up where he left off. I read that one. Already read that one. All right, number five. 109, if they did not work, they would be cut. If they worked, they had to pass the terrible ABC test. Oh, right. Page number six, page 111. Distinction that was established between EMEA and the Metropolitan, a league of whites. Other league, mulattoes and blacks all mixed together. The separation came about naturally. Commission of Inquiry of EMEA went against São Cristóvão. Any club that had blacks would be under suspicion. I'm puzzled by this section. How can the separation among players occur naturally? Echo, echo, thought somebody said that. When you have a commission whose seemingly sole purpose is to police the participation of black players. Echo, echo, did somebody? See how soccer scandals taint national obsession of Brazil. Got that one as well. Mora Costa. Oh, I've read that one before. That's why we heard it, but I did repeat that also. Number 7, page 113. Mora Costa, others play jokes on him, dress themselves up as ghosts to scare him with white sheets walking. Pranking is such a large part of white culture, they call it tomfoolery. This reminds me a little of the scene in the original Birth of a Nation movie. The movie came out in 1915. Maybe some of the suspected racists in Brazil saw it. Remember the hints of Bill Russell's autobiography. I cannot agree more. There's so much of racism that is about racist jokes, right? So much of it is about, one, terrorizing black people and having fun doing it. Now, this is happening, we're talking early 20th century. This is like the Klan heyday, or at least one of their intervals of having a heyday where they have lots of membership and getting attention all across the country, all across the world. There are race soldiers in other parts of the world who employ the symbolism and imagery of the Klan. So that's not, you know, unique to just this part of the world, right? But yeah, those the jokes and all of that, I'm pretty sure that they heard about what was happening here in the U.S. and, oh, that'll be fun, let's go and scare the niggers, ooh, and as a ghost too, like, come on. Number 8, page 113, Fluminense bonfire setting off rockets. Suspected racists love bonfires and bombs. All of that is just battle simulation. I said before, it's war. They do all the firecrackers and explosions. They have, if you look at a lot of the football stadiums, they have cannons, literally. Tampa Bay Buccaneers, the great Tom Brady, right? Just for the cannons and what have you. All at the stadium, they score a touchdown. They look, bang, bang, fire the cannons and the guns and all that. I mean, white ball game, simulation for battle. Number 9, page 115. Fluminense players wearing tuxedos. Were the tuxedos black? I recall Dr. Welsing talking about the symbolism of black tuxedos, and the little black dress may also be a clever way of distinguishing themselves from clubs with non-white players who could not afford such haberdashery. She did talk about that book, Men in Black. We had the author of that text as a guest on the program, May 2009. Number 10, page 116, mulatto on the side, show that Emea was not as much against black players. Good that Vasco joining Emea. Emea needed a club with an immigrant community. An example of racial showcasing, perhaps? That's what it sounds like to me. And a mulatto player. See, that's what I mean about the distinctions. They didn't say it was good that they had at least one Negro on the side. It's good that they had at least one blood. That's not what they said. One mulatto. He didn't even say person of color or non-white player. That's not what they said. And he said, it's good we had one mulatto player on the side to show that we are not against black players. They didn't even say against players of color, against non-white players. We're against black players. And to show that we're not against you niggers, we'll get a player who has a white parent. See? See, he's not even too dark. See, look at that. Almost got blonde hair. See, number 111, page 117 to 120. Vasco would never lift the championship cup. Players had to work. Commission of Inquiry would not leave Vasco in peace. Commission of Inquiry had a trick. They did not ask for the player. They asked for the employee. Commissioners consult the aliases of the players. Before Vasco, fans were respectful, were even angrier. Players sullying themselves by playing against Velasco. All the maneuvering to keep those dirty non-white players from taking over. The dedication required to maintain white supremacy. Now that's even interesting because he used the term taking over. That kind of goes back to what Lauren was saying. She thinks this, you know, theme of this text is about white anxiety, white genetic annihilation in some sense, right? White black players taking over our ball game, right? and saying that, yeah, it's all this. We got to have a commission. And wait a minute. We got to check your literacy. Wait a minute. Whoa. Got to check. Do you really work here? You got an alias? Wait a minute. Where's your boss at? Where's your supervisor? All of this. Like, really? Really? For a ball game? Is that serious? Anyway, page 121 to 122, Flamengo would win the championship only wanting white players. Dr. Faustino Esposel, medical doctor, president of the Flamengo, bread and honey, horse steak, Donna Odette, egg threads, made player open their mouth as if they were a little boy. This seems like they're resorting to all these bizarre rituals to somehow win championships and at the same time struggling to keep the team white. And I think they did say that they would bring in a non-white player if he could help them win. They had mentioned that before, right? Like, and especially for a black player, you already got to be great. Like, we're not bringing you in, and we're going to train you up and get you right and coach you and teach you how to read and all. Like, you already got to have some skills that you picked up playing with the street urchins and the lot. And then, yeah, if you'll help us get a chip, let's do it. Okay, pause there. Let me get backing up, get a few of my notes. Went too far. Okay. All right, from chapter 3. So the good times had returned. You know about that? Good times. We don't have any black players. And they get the black players specifically. They say had some mulattoes. Only Bangu and Sal Cristobal had some mulattoes and black players. It was something else to play like that. White with white now was a pleasure to prepare for the games. Dr. Welsing even talked about that with tennis, another sport with a lot of white people dominating. And she said that when Arthur Ashe, the late legend Arthur Ashe, when he started to ascend into his prime, that so many of the white players, it was war, battle. We got to win. I'll die to win this game. And Arthur Ashe, it just wasn't that way. They just go out and have fun with the white players. Like, wow, this is not even fun anymore in terms of us playing this game. If we got non-white, especially black players, like, oh my God, we got to kill them during the game and beat them down and all the rest of this. If it's just white, we can just get back to having fun if it's all white guys. They slept at the club. Let's see. Almost all the white players, they slept at the club. Only Leo and Kaleo of the Naval War School and Nascimento, who never got used to all the noise of Fluminense dormitory with the players playing around and throwing pillows at one another, were not obligated to sleep at the club. Now, you know, this is another one where I go again. Is this, I'm not sleeping here because I don't want to be around all these antics, especially as we continue reading. Like, are you serious? Is the homoeroticism as well? That's what I said, too, with all these pranks. Right? A lot, so much of that gets homoerotic. We're there messing around with people asleep, throwing pillows. And again, I bet this is sanitized, throwing pillows, especially if they're drinking and doing all of that. And oh, we got a horse around while you're in the shower. And oh, we got to do something to you while you're asleep. And oh, while you're drunk and passed out, we got to mess with you. Like, come, man, that right there, reason enough. I'm cool. I'm good. I said bedtime was at 11. It really has been 10, but players thought that was too early since 10 was when Llamas was getting good. So we got to go out and party and drink and all the rest of it. Even so, there were those who would arrive later when the gate was locked and the guard had orders to shoot if he saw someone jumping over the wall. What? They got so many guns and violence. I don't even know what to say about that. So much of this is supposed to be about sports, right? Ball games, and they're shooting fans, and we got a brawl out in the streets and everything else. This fella almost gets shot coming in after curfew. Let me see. Fortes slept at his own house like Nascimento. Nascimento slept at his house and lived in Tijuca. Even so, by the time other players woke up, he had already jumped the rope, finished doing his laps. If he would wait for others, he would get to Sucre, Brazil, I guess, late city, which was where he worked. This time where these white people have time to lounge. They can be out, drink all night, brag about not having to go to work, call other people slaves, who have to go into work or what have you, have time to lounge around and just play soccer all day long. All of this, just, we can mock the fact that we don't work. That is a part of white culture. You even see that today, that we have all of this leisure time, right? Super Bowl or whatever else it is, whatever other activities that we have. We can sleep late. I talk about sleep all the time. Right. Forgive audio. But yeah, having the leisure to lounge like that, you don't have to worry and have your alarm clock to get up. Even they talked about time on the other end where they had the black workers at the factory where they had to run and sprint after work, right, to get off. They would get off at 4, and then they'd have to get the train and try and, you know, do all that. They're not like a privileged soccer star where you could take the day off. Even they had that where some of them, they would get paid for that day if it was really important, that sort of thing. But not all the players got that sort of privilege. Leisure time. Let's see. It was difficult to get Harold Fortes, Floriano, Pettit, Zizi, Legardo, and Nilo out of bed since all of them had plenty of free time. Further, Mora Costa had no beef with Nascimento, whereas the other players' jokes on him dressing themselves up as ghosts to scare him. Talked about that, all of that, you know. I could not imagine black players, mulatto players, whatever, dressing up and doing all these pranks. They talked about how they can't retaliate during the games and they got to be super careful about their hair and clothing and all the rest of it. I cannot imagine them, you know, we're going to gang up and go do this and mess up their clothes and dump something on them while they're asleep or whatever. Let's see. And then when it gets so bad, they terrorize him. At one point, he faints from them in their white sheets walking around and stalking him. Like, come on. And he... come on. Let's see. The dormer, he liked that life. Llamas, the matrices, the glorious staircase, the dormitory with its pillow fights. And its ghost, the ghost did not drag the sheets through the halls of Fluminense only to scare Mora Costa. Sometimes they would dress up like ghosts and go to the Cubs bar like after St. John's party. I mean, that's where they go into the setting all about all of this. Like I said that like a couple of weeks ago, like so much of this has that like frat house, white fraternity house vibe where we just get together, get drunk, have our big drunken frat parties and what have you, and pass out, wake up the next morning, do our pranks on like that's what it's been like the whole way through. And the other frat houses, right, we get together and we do pranks on the other frat houses, right, because they talked about that. So some of the soccer clubs, they do pranks, we talked about that earlier, they tar the other soccer club and all of that. It has such that homo social, homo erotic fraternity house vibe throughout the entirety of the book. I think that could be why so many of these non-white players have been saying, nah, I'm good, I'm not hanging out, I'm are you serious? And you all are going to terrorize me and make me literally, pun intended, be butt of the joke in all of this. I'm good. I don't even want to shower at the same time y'all in here. I'm good. Let's see. And they got to get the ghosts with all the drinking, of course. Let's see. All of the, so much of this, the opulence that these white ball clubs, where they can really spoil their players, and it keeps coming back to food, while they are so frequently talking about black players, black people, period, non-white people in Brazil, who are starving, don't have any of that. I mean, that's this period, so 1920, we'll say, or right now, 2023, black people starving, not having enough food, while white people are just, you know, bragging about our opulent, delectable Negro, like through and through. Let's see. Anything else? The tuxedos, same thing as well. where they would, the white, because Fluminense is one of those elite white clubs, all of that. We break steak and ham and eggs and all the rest of it. Even that, the tuxedos, and I've talked about that too, the focus on wardrobe and what have you, where you can do tuxedos where all the players don't have one, can't even afford to get one. I'm sure you've got lots of black players where they're working at the no-count factory where they cannot afford even all of this. Another way where we can just go out and brag about the opulence that we have. And again, all of this wealth, resources, enslavement of black people, direct. Let's see. Tuxedos being as important as their cleats, shorts, and jersey. That is men in black. John Hall, I think is it. John Hall is the white man who wrote that book. He's in England, as unless my memory is bad. Let's see. You got to go all into the pajamas and everything, too? Like, come on. I think I'll rest there. Yes, I will rest there. We'll pick up in chapter 3 for next Thursday. Again, we're closing in on the halfway point. Not quite, but we've read a good chunk to start be making some assessments about what we think all of this is about with the text. Anywho, if folks listen in, email, what have you, feel free to write in commentary. We'll pick them up as we go. Again, narrator, spectacular effort. It would have been so grueling, not, perhaps even impossible if I had to do the narration this week with so much going on. So huge gratitude to our narrator for being professional, Johnny on the spot, getting everything done. Whew, wouldn't be possible without your assistance. We'll be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, for Neutralizing Workplace Racism. And then Saturday, compensatory call-in. Dial in about 24 hours. We'll chat it up about workplace or racism in the workplace, what to do. Much obliged for folks tuning in for the Katherine Massey Book Club. Hopefully it has been worthy of your Thursday evening. We will be back with the book next week. Sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. Whew. For so many reasons, we need a well-functioning brain computer. Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. No name calling, no gossiping, no throwaway offspring. We are not contributing to non-white urchins anywhere in the known universe. Cow signing out, live from Buffalo. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, your brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.